Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, many, many years ago, when I received the call document to serve in my first parish, I read through the document and I noticed the job description. They had a little job description, and you know what a job description is. It describes what you're supposed to do. Well, here this congregation was calling me as their pastor. It was my first call, and in those days you really had no choice. You had to take it because you were assigned that parish from seminary. But anyways, they were nice enough to send me a call document, and so I read very carefully the job description. And you know what the job description said? The pastor shall be conservative in hairstyle. I nailed it. Today's gospel is a job description. Oh, the language is quite nice, but nevertheless, it's a job description. In today's gospel, Jesus goes to Nazareth. It's his hometown. And when he goes to Nazareth, as was his custom, he went to the synagogue to worship on the Sabbath day. And he was handed the scroll of Isaiah, and he read from what we would call Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to declare release to the captive, to give sight to the blind, and to declare a jubilee year of the Lord. This is a beautiful job description of what the Messiah will do when the Messiah will come. Well, Jesus surprises everyone when he's finished reading the lesson. After reading Isaiah 61, he rolls up the scroll, gives it to the attendant, sits down, and all eyes are fixed on him. And he says, oh, by the way, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. What he's really saying to them is, I'm that Messiah. I'm the one that has been sent to you by God. My job as Messiah is to preach good news to the poor, to preach freedom to the captive, and proclaim liberty to those who are oppressed, and to declare a jubilee year of the Lord. I'm the Messiah. I'm going to do that, says Jesus. Now, at first, they are just wowed by the marvelous, gracious words that come out of Jesus' mouth. They just love what he says. But then, and this wasn't in today's gospel, it follows it, but then doubt begins to rise. Someone asks, now wait a minute, isn't this Jacob's son, Joseph's son? And then all of a sudden they begin to realize what Jesus had said. Hey, this Jesus has said, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. I am that Messiah. I'm the one that God has sent. And they become enraged. They become so angry with Jesus that they literally throw him out of the synagogue. And what they really want to do is drive him to the brow of a cliff and throw him off a cliff in Nazareth. They are so enraged and angry with him, they want to kill him. Of course, this is a foretaste of things to come. But in this gospel today, Jesus says that he is the Messiah in a very clear way. Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. And what he's saying is that he's going to fulfill this job description. And preaching is central to his ministry. And not only is preaching central to his ministry, but look at what his preaching does. His preaching produces freedom. He will free the captives. He will free those who are oppressed. And his preaching produces healing. He will give sight to the blind. And when I look at this job description of the Messiah, in which he's called to preach, he's called to free people up, he's called to heal people, That to me is also a beautiful job description of the Christian congregation. Today we have our annual meeting, and we will be looking over reports of the various committees. We'll be looking at the work that this congregation has done in the past year, but that also sets the tone and tenor for the future too. We do ministry in this place, and what should be important to us? And I think this congregation has been blessed with resources to carry out the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as a congregation, what is our first order of business? The first order of business is to preach and teach, to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with as many people as we can. And here, as a pastor, I want to say a word of thank you. You know, I've been with you for about 17 months. And what I find amazing about preaching, I love to preach, I love to proclaim. But what I find amazing about it is that you folks come back week after week, month after month, year after year. And every preacher needs to say to the congregation, thank you. Thank you for doing that. Thank you for coming back time and time again. What other profession do people keep coming back to hear? Oh, you can go to a political rally, but after one, two, or three of those kind of fizzle out. But you come back week after week after week after week to listen. That's the gift that a congregation gives a pastor. You give your time, your hearing, yourself, Sunday after Sunday, and that's amazing. And I also want to say thank you, especially to Terry. Terry broadcasts, he tapes these sermons. He puts them on YouTube Sunday after Sunday. I know I view them. And not only that, we've been doing some monthly vignettes. He's put them out there, and sometimes as many as, well, thousands of people listen to these things. Thank you for listening. Thank you for the opportunity to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what we as a congregation must do. And what should our preaching do? It should do more than entertain us. It should do more than make us laugh or put us in a good humor. Our preaching should free up people so that they can serve. We should free up the captive and those oppressed so that they can serve, so that they can be healed. And once again, this congregation does a marvelous job. Look at all you do. You're not a huge congregation, you're a small congregation. But I'm amazed at how much you do. You support a seminarian, and you support him in a very real way. Not only that, you support the mission program of our synod and of our church. And not only that, but you do wonderful. The ladies gather together and do these quilts for Lutheran World Relief, and they collect items for health kits and school kits and nursery kits. It's marvelous what this congregation can do. And then the care and the concern that you show for one another in very real ways. It's more than you're just in our thoughts and prayers. But this congregation reaches out to its own, and not just to its own, but to others in very real ways to help people, to heal people, to free people. And that's what a jubilee year is. You know, one of the things that Jesus said in today's gospel was that he would bring in the jubilee year. Let me explain that custom for a moment. The jubilee year happened every 50th year. And on that 50th year, what would happen is everyone was like given a second chance. It was like you're freed up to start anew, a fresh start. But imagine, if you're a slave, you're freed. If you owe a mortgage, you're free of that. If you have debt, you're free of that. Imagine if in our society today, that every 50th year, all your debts would just disappear. Wouldn't that be wonderful? That'd be a wonderful custom, but I suspect it's not going to happen. But it would bring great joy to all of us to see a Jubilee year. And Jesus does that. He brings a Jubilee year. But best of all, Jesus isn't just freeing our financial debts. He's freeing the debt that we owe God. He's freeing the sin that stains our soul. He's freeing us by his death on the cross. He has become that sacrifice so that we can be cleansed, so that we can be purified, so that we can be made the very best, so that we can go out and serve one another and serve the world and proclaim the gospel, preaching, teaching, healing, and proclaiming freedom. That's the task of the Christian congregation. That's the task of Grace and Peace Lutheran Church. And we rejoice that God has blessed this congregation so that we are able to serve. You have a bright future. I hope and pray that Mary Bankin will accept the call here. I think some things are still being worked out there. These things can be time consuming. You just got to be patient. I know we want it to happen yesterday, but maybe it'll happen tomorrow. Just be patient. But you have a bright future. First of all, I understand. I saw some of Mary's stuff online. She's a fantastic preacher. She has a fellowship from Luther Seminary. In preaching, this whole year, she's devoted her life to preaching. And I know she's preached in Israel, over in Palestine. And it's been a remarkable opportunity for her. So I know she's a good preacher, and you continue that ministry of preaching here with her. And also, the congregation here has some resources. You have resources that few congregations have. Resources that you can use for ministry. Resources you can use to train seminarians to become pastors. Resources that you can use to support the Synod and the ELCA mission programs. You have the resources that you can reach out and preach and teach and heal and bring people freedom from their sins and freedom from the debt we owe God and one another. You have a remarkable future in front of you. So rejoice. And today, as you look over those reports in your annual minutes, your annual meeting report book, when you see that report, give a prayer. Thank God for what goes on in this place. And pray that God bless your future. And I know that God will be with you, and you will be able to preach and teach and declare the Jubilee year of the Lord is coming. So rejoice and be glad. In Jesus' name, amen.